Adrian Seeger, beginning his fifth career, now designs events.
So this is going to be a bit of a rant about why we're scared about changing our conference designs, some things we're doing wrong, and some things that we can do to make our conferences better. And the first question really is how do we get here? How do we get to the place that we're in right now, where events are? This is a 40-year-old photograph. That's me with a blue circle, about 18 years old, the freshman class at Merton College, Oxford University. And Oxford University is the oldest university in the English-speaking world. It was founded 900 years ago. And when it was founded, there were no printed books. Okay, all you could get was stuff like this, very, very expensive stuff. Big libraries in the world, the biggest libraries had a couple of hundred of these. So if you wanted to learn something, what did you have to do? You had to go to a person who knew that thing, and they told it to you, or maybe showed it to you. That was the only way you could learn. Okay, 400 years go by, Gutenberg invents movable type, we get books. It's all too late. It's in our culture. This is how we learn stuff, by sitting and listening to people. Okay? I mean, and we've had 20 years now, we've had devices like this. I can carry this device around. I can get amazing content on this device. I don't even have to go and get a book anymore. And yet we're still sitting listening to people. Okay? Now, the one ray of sunshine about my time in Oxford was the Oxford tutorial. Every week I would go and meet with my professor, maybe one-on-one, maybe with one or two other students. It would be small group learning. We would learn stuff, we would discuss stuff, it was interactive. That's where I learned most of the physics that I learned at Oxford, the really important stuff, in small groups. The reality is that you can shovel content at people, you know, till you're blue in the face, and there's no guarantee that any learning is going to go on. Now, there's a lot of controversy and research and controversy about the best ways to learn stuff. I mean, it's still a hot topic. But here's one way that we've all learned for years. 20-second video. Watch what the learning's going on for this little kid. Okay, throws the ball to his big sister. I have to let go of it. Okay. Oh, this is water. That's wet. Oh, that's what water feels like. Okay. Let's try with this one. I threw it better that time. Oh, hi, Mom. Hi, Mom. Taking the picture. 20 seconds of learning. Okay. That's how all of us learn. All right. There's some lessons there, I believe. The question I want to think about is how much of your really important things you learned in your life did you learn sitting in rooms like this? Just think about that for a moment. Okay, let's contrast that with this picture of Andrew, Pete, and Nancy. You can tell just from the still photo there's learning going on. There's interaction, there's involvement, there's engagement. You know, stuff is happening here. It's not clear who's learning from whom. Maybe it doesn't really matter. Maybe it flips from moment to moment. There isn't a defined student and teacher. This is a small group. Stuff is happening. Learning is social. If you want to compare, now one thing that is really a problem with traditional conferences is hierarchy. When you say that these people over here are the speakers and the presenters and everybody else are attendees who are supposed to listen passively, you have cut out all these possibilities for your event. Instead, you want to think of your attendees as resources, not as your customers. You want to think of them as resources. And it's win-win. When they're resources and they participate and they can make the event the way they want it, they are participating, they're learning better, and they're enjoying it much more. Think about it that way. Another thing we're doing wrong in conferences, most traditional events are sort of mishmash of sessions sandwiched between a beginning, a pro forma welcome, and a sort of a standard, you know, bye-bye. You know, and we can do better than that. We can create events that have flow. This is my Tai Chi teacher, Gerda Geddes, recently deceased, unfortunately. And she taught me about flow. And when you can have flow in an event, you can create an event that has, like Lara said, a beginning, a middle, and an end, a story that's unique for each person, that's meaningful for each person. Here's another thing that doesn't work. About events, a process of events. You've got to remember the group process doesn't scale. Stuff that works really well for 10 or 15 people in a group, you can't use those same processes for 50. The stuff that works well for 50 you will not work well for 200 or 1,000 people. Small group stuff, however, is the key, whatever you do. And people often say, well, how do you get people to participate in an event? So it's a pretty important question. And my answer is you use an event design where every single person at the event can shape the event. When that's possible, when people know that, people do participate. You give them that possibility, that freedom, to make the event what it is they want it to be. Another thing is ground rules. Don't have time to go into this. There's a lot in my book and some blog posts that I have. Using explicit ground rules at the beginning of the event, not things about turning off pages, but ground rules about safety, about the right to ask questions, things like that. When you do that, that transforms events. You basically give permission for things to happen in your event. Structure at events. Sometimes I think the traditional event planners are like the guy who used to walk in front of the horseless carriages, keeping everybody safe and making sure that the folks in the horse industry didn't lose their jobs. What you really want in your events is just the right amount of structure and support. Not too much, because that cuts off possibilities. Not too little, because then you'll have chaos. Okay, you want just the right amount, and getting that right amount is an art. Like a fine Italian bicycle, just the right amount of weight and structure to get you where you want it to go. Final point, when you take all these things that I've been talking about, the right amount of final of support and structure, lack of hierarchy, ground rules, and so on, you get events that are much more than the sum of their parts. You get synergistic events. And when you do that, when you put all these things together, you get events that are like dances. Now, dancing is kind of scary. It's something you do in public. Other people can see you. You don't really know what's going to happen, But it's when you get into dancing, it's wonderful and it's fun. And my challenge to you is to create events that are like that. Thank you very much. And we have 1 minute. And so I want to take that minute to get the other five presenters out here for a final round of applause. I also want to thank the technical folks. You did a beautiful job. That was perfect. Very good. So come on all out. We've never done this before. And I think Elling, he's on a 20-second delay. So I don't know if he got the message. Did he?
Oh, can we tell what we were going to do last night when we watched this video?
Ka-cha, ka-cha.